Good morning, everybody. Please take your living hymns and go to number 426. Number 426. Set on every hand, doubt and fear and things of earth in vain to me are calling. None of these shall move me from Beulah land. I'm living on the mountain underneath the cloudless sky. Praise God, I'm drinking at the fountain that never shall run dry. Oh yes, I'm feasting on the manna from a bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in Beulah land. Far below the storm of doubt upon the world is beating, sons of men in battle on the enemy withstand. Safe am I within the castle of God's word retreating. Nothing then can reach me, 'tis Beulah land. I'm living on the mountain underneath the cloudless sky. Praise God, I'm drinking at the fountain that never shall run dry. Oh yes, I'm feasting on the manna from the bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in Beulah land. Let the stormy breezes blow, their cry cannot alarm me. I am safely sheltered here, protected by God's hand. Here the sun is always shining, here there's naught can harm me. I am safe forever in Beulah land. I'm living on the mountain underneath the cloudless sky. Praise God, I'm drinking at the fountain that never shall run dry. Oh yes, I'm feasting on the manna from the bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in Beulah land. Viewing here the works of God, I sing in contemplation. Hearing now the blessed voice, I see the way he planned. Dwelling in the Spirit here, I learn a full salvation. Gladly will I tarry in Beulah land. I'm living on the mountain underneath the cloudless sky. Praise God, I'm drinking at the fountain that never shall run dry. Oh yes, I'm feasting on the manna from a bountiful supply, for I am dwelling in Beulah land. Now go to number 869. Brethren, we have met to worship and adore the Lord our God. Will you pray with all your power? sinking down. Brethren, pray, holy manna will be showered all around. Sisters, will you join and help us? Moses' sister aided him. Will you help the trembling mourners who are struggling hard with sin? All about the Savior, tell them that he will be found. Sisters, pray, and holy manna will be showered all around. Let us love our God supremely. Let us love each other too. Let us love and pray for sinners till our God makes all things new. Then he'll call us home to heaven. At his table we'll sit down. Christ will gird himself and serve us with sweet manna all around.
I like verse 3 where it says, pray for the lost sinners, that the Holy Ghost might come down. Someone prayed for this lost sinner many years. Holy Ghost brought this lost sinner into this church. Holy Ghost saved this sinner. The glory of heaven came down. Go to number 796. Heaven came down, and glory filled my soul. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we want the glory of God to come down and fill the house of God this week.
Amen. Yes, sir.
We want heaven to come down, and glory to fill this place. 796.
Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day, day I will never forget. After I wandered in darkness away, Jesus, my Savior, I met. Oh, what a tender, compassionate friend, he met the need of my heart. Shadows dispelling with joy, I am telling, he made all the darkness depart. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Born of the Spirit with life from above, into God's family divine. Justified fully through Calvary's love, oh, what a standing is mine. And the transaction so quickly was made, when as a sinner I came. Took of the offer of grace he did proffer, he saved me, praise his dear name. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Now the hope that will surely endure after the passing of time. I have a future in heaven for sure, there in those mansions sublime. And it's because of that wonderful day when at the cross I believe. Riches eternal and blessings supernal from his precious hand I receive. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole, my sins he washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul.
Good singing. All right, remain standing. Let's sing that little chorus. There's something mighty sweet about the Lord, all right? There's something mighty sweet about the Lord. There's something mighty sweet about the Lord. It really doesn't matter what the people say. There's something mighty sweet. Amen. You can be seated. It's all about Him this week. It's not about us.
Well, the preacher, he's too young, or maybe he's too old. The sermons, they're not hard enough, and maybe they're too bold. His voice is much too quiet-like. Sometimes he gets too loud. He needs to have more dignity, or else he's way too proud. Well, the sermons, they're too long, or maybe they're too short. He ought to preach the word with dignity instead of stomp and snort. Well, that preacher we've got must be the world's most stuck-up man. One of the ladies told me the other day, he didn't even shake my hand.
Excuses, you hear them every day. And the devil, he'll supply them if from church you stay away. When people come to know the Lord, the devil always loses. So to keep them folks away from church, he offers them.
I'd rather be his than have riches on
you stop to think about those words, you'd rather have Jesus than anything.
Amen.
That's our heart, but I wonder, you know, how many times we say that. We might not really mean it at that exact moment. We got so many things on our mind, and we get overwhelmed with things. But when we realize that He's all that we have, we understand He's all that we need. Amen. Well, I am excited about this week. I'm glad the Lord is letting us have the meeting. And no doubt in my mind that the Lord has ordained this. And God knows He's orchestrated it all, put it all together. And we're going to have the right reverend, esteemed, highly well-known and famous husband of Candy Nagowski preach to us today. And so I've been praying about it, just trying to follow the Lord. And so Brother Nagowski is going to preach this morning and tonight. And so you pray for him. And Dr. Bob, you come on up. And we were talking yesterday. I couldn't remember exactly where and when we met, but it was in Michigan 22 years ago. And I appreciate his friendship. And let the Lord speak to your heart today through the preaching. Amen.
I don't think. Is this on?
Yeah.
Everybody can hear me?
Yeah.
Too bad. Yeah. Well, we are definitely glad to be here. We love the state. I mean, it's like Michigan in so many ways. And you got a weird governor, too, I heard.
Yeah.
They got to go. But we appreciate your pastor, Stacy, and over the years. And it's good just to grow together in the Lord, see people. It's so good to see the same people in church.
Amen.
You know,
amen.
A lot of years. Being a pastor all these years, I'll be probably a little less evangelistic and more trying to help your growth. And what you need to remember at the meeting is everybody in here should know that we're commanded to be full of the Holy Ghost. That's everybody. But a lot of times you depend on me. No. You need to be full so you can hear it right. I don't want you leaving here and saying, well, you hear what he said? And everybody's saying, no, he didn't say that. And,
yes, he did.
You know, you hear different things. And we're weird kind of people, you know. We had people next to us where they put us to lodge, you know. The perception was to take a picture of their plate, you know, just in case, you know, our joint would broke into next door or something, you know. And we were at Gene's, and I was saying, yeah, just watch these people be nice people and all this stuff and all those perceptions. Yeah, we met them this morning. They're Baptists and can't figure out why there ain't so many Baptist churches in Maine and stuff. I said, well, you know, Yankees, you know, a long time ago, you know. And he's a retired minister. What did you do? I said, it figures. It figures. God's got a sense of humor. He's got a comedian in the family. But you do the same thing. And the problem is you don't realize we're going to get judged for that stuff. And so it gets a little serious every now and then. I want to preach on taking the obstacles away, taking the obstacles away. Amen. What's obstacles? Well, things that hinder. Things that hinder. In my office at church, my library there, the shelf has points on it, you know. And it happens when you come in my door right here, the shelf's about here. And it's got a point. And a copier is underneath that. Well, I mean, it took me 20 years, but I finally cut that corner off. Why? It was an obstacle. Why? Because I kept hitting it. And you men in here know what I'm talking about. You're just stubborn as all hell. You are stubborn. My wife said, oh, it's a beautiful picture. Why don't you go back? Because I don't go back. I passed it. I ain't going back. She says, well, if you got lost, you'd go back. Well, that's if I got lost. But everything else, just something in you, just rebellious, man. It's just like, I ain't got, no, I'm going here, I'm going there. Oh, that's a nice thing, we ought to stop. Well, too late, past it. We'll go back. No. Well, there's instructions. So? So what?
Yeah.
Takes you a lot of years to figure out the stuff you were missing was very important. Especially if you're working on engines. Somebody's going to be a mechanic, I heard. Yeah. And, yeah, you know, you got a few bolts left over. Oh, well. It runs. It runs, right? And sometimes you find out later on that that bolt should have been in there. A lot of times it don't. So we just go on. So you guys, you know, we know where you're at. If you're manly. Unless you're one of these foo-foos, these effeminates, you know. Apparently Christians don't know that that's in the Bible, that word, effeminate.
Yeah, it is.
You know, and if we were going to be the same as the woman, God would have just kept us one, figured out the rest, right? Oh, that's just a little introduction. And since you don't have Sunday school, so, I mean, I got liberty. We're just going to, you know, and if you do, I'll just have them sing that song again. And, so you're going to have problems, amen. So I'm hoping I can add to the meeting. I'm hoping, well, you always hope.
Yeah.
But God does get in them. For 25 years, we started this. Lanny Hasbrook and Brother Henson told me I needed to have a camp meeting. Not a conference, a camp meeting.
Right.
And so we did with no money. What are we going to name the meeting? If you ever go on YouTube, it's The Beggars. If you ever see the beggars, that's from our meeting, and Beggars Meeting. And then even have Brother Later, why would you name it Beggars? What does a beggar do? You people beg for money? Well, we're begging God for money. And sometimes it wouldn't come until Thursday.
Yeah.
I was a nervous wreck. You know, wouldn't let anybody know, but inside you're like, oh man, oh man. And then it come through, 25 years. So what does that tell you? God comes through.
Yeah.
Just obey God. As a husband, as a wife, family, you got to learn to obey God. All right. I didn't pray, did I, Ma? Did I pray? Okay. Man, forget when you get older. Father, we love you. We thank you for your mercy, your grace. We ask that the Holy Ghost of God would fill us. Give me clarity of thought, liberty of speech. Be with the hearer, Father. And all this week, Father, we need your spirit to be with the hearers because the benefit is to the church. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So the first point is instructions on self-government. Imagine that, having a problem with self-government. Imagine people and our forefathers actually telling people that without self-government, our Constitution is not going to work. Imagine them coming up with something like that, self-government. Amen. Well, let's go some verses. Romans 13. Might be a while getting to these verses because I didn't mark them. Over here in chapter 13, and let's read 12 to 14. Romans 12 to 14, first point is instructions on self-government. The Bible says, did I say 11 or 14? Okay, 12 to 14. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, nor in strife and envying. Whenever you looked at the Bible, some people read that, well, yeah, if you're saved, you're not going to do all that. That's not what Paul's talking about. He's talking to the brethren. He's saying don't do that. He started off with putting off some stuff. Just so you read it right, whenever Paul says us, we're included. Whenever that word should do this, what does that mean? It means you could not do it. People get all messed up in the church. They start doubting their salvation because sometimes preaching just ain't scriptural. And they go out and never come back, thinking they can't do it. They never could do it. You couldn't save yourself. Jesus had to. And you're not going to make this life, Christian life, without Jesus. And so he's saying there's some things you got to put on, some things you got to put off. Bless God. And it's pretty simple, actually. And verse 14. But put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the what? Flesh. To do what? Fulfill the lust thereof. Man, we camped there. How do you know all about that? Because I'm an authority on the flesh. I got a PhD in that. I'm 71, believe me. Yeah, we tried a lot of things. Amen. So what are you going to do? You're going to cast off, you're going to put off, and you're going to walk right. Go to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22. Bible says that you put off concerning the former conversation, the old man. Yep. Yep. Former conversation.
Right. Amen.
And what's wrong with that? Well, if you look under it, it says, which is corrupt.
Yep. Right.
According to the deceitful lusts. Deceitful lusts. Look at 24. And that you put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. And in verse 31, let all bitterness and wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Wow. I didn't have 32 in the message, but because it bothers me. But anyway, okay. And be kind one to another. Tender-hearted. Oh, man. Forgiving one another. And then God's got to put this in here. Even as God, for Christ's sake, hath forgiven you. Why do you do it? Because how many sins were forgiven for you? Past, present, and future. So you have no right. You have absolutely no right as a Christian to hold grudges and be bitter. If you're a man, I don't know how you feel. Some men have got a little tenderness. We're supposed to have tenderness according to the Bible. Since some guys just... it's just rough having tenderness, that's all. Yeah. Anyway, so what have we discovered so far? Let's see, cast off, put off, walk right, put off, put on, and do. And in Colossians chapter 3, in your Bible really is, my new Bible I'm using from Mr. Craig Cobb. Pages are still stuck together a little bit. Colossians 3, yeah, 8, 9, 10, yep, 3, 8, 9, 10, yep. But now you also put off all these. You notice it says, but now you also, another message is the previous verses, but anyway. In the which you also walked sometime when you lived in them, look at that. But now you also put off all these, anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Why not? That's L-I-E. One to another. Well, we're just fooling around. No, you lying dog.
Yep.
Men can lie. Man.
Yep.
But we don't think it is. We have different definitions than God sometimes. Amen.
Yep.
And you... anyway, lie not one to another, seeing that you have put off the old man with his deeds, and have put on the new man... which is renewed, that means it has to happen again and again, right?
Yeah.
In knowledge, that's in your brain, right? After who? After the image of him that created him. And let's see here. And then 12 and 14. Put on therefore as the elect God, holy and beloved bowels of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, and long-suffering. Forbearing one another and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. And above all these things, put on charity, which is bound, which is the bond of perfectness.
Right.
I mean, so we therefore are responsible from them verses that we just read. And we have to remember that pride hates submission. Pride hates to submit.
Oh, that's right.
You got to remember that because it's part of you. And it hates what? Humility. And I'm a Trumpite. Sorry. So far. But the guy's cussing, trying to be cool with everybody. And he's always telling people how cool he is. See, that rubs me. That's when Cassius Clay, which was his real birth name before he become a Muslim, I am the greatest. Man, I was just hoping somebody knock his block off. Didn't really happen, but I was hoping. I can't stand that stuff. So God, it's scary anyway what's going on in our country. And I'm just telling you, maybe you're like me, you know, you hear it, you know what's coming, and I understand politically he's got to do a lot of stuff, but humility? I don't know. Anyway, your pride definitely hates submission, humility, and commitment. Now, submission to the King James Bible, humility and letting others help? Yeah. Then how about allowing instruction and in doing it? Because the doing it is commitment. And committing to these things are pretty rough for people. Why? Because of pride.
Right.
And number two, the remedy for obstacles are twofold. Jesus and others. Go to John 11. John chapter 11. Now, I'm hoping you use your brain when I preach. I mean, to think a little bit. Because you read the scriptures, they got to sink in. Listen to comments. I mean, evaluate. I mean, be a critical thinker.
Yeah.
You know, scriptures always answer any argument.
Right.
But you got to learn. Now, in the 50s and 60s, even some of the 70s, people had enough sense in the family to go see what grandpa had to say. They really did. The ladies would find out recipes and think about what grandma had to say.
Yeah.
Somehow you valued wisdom.
Yeah.
You know, of accumulation of years. Now you go to the internet and, oh, that sounds good. This sounds good. And a lot of things aren't even proven.
That's right.
And you run off with that stuff. You got to be careful. You got to be careful. In John chapter 11 and verse 1, it says, "Now a certain man was sick named Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary, and her sister Martha." Martha. So the remedy for obstacles, once again, is Jesus and others. And here's a great story. Great, praise the Lord. A great story of, if you look at it, of Jesus Christ's resurrected power. Look at verse 4 of the chapter. "When Jesus heard that, he said, 'This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified therein.'" Yeah. Who said that? Jesus said that. Look at verse 25 and 26. "Jesus said unto her, 'I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die.'" And he looks at her, "Believest thou this?" And what's she going to say? Look, "Yea, Lord, and I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world." Now, what was her problem? Well, she didn't have a problem. She was a Jew, Old Testament. They all believed in resurrection. Remember the Valley of Dry Bones one day? So she's just dispensationally wrong here. Christ is here now. The Messiah is here. And he's telling her, "I'm the resurrection." So we know at the millennial thing, before the end of the tribulation, that they're going to rise. Yeah, it's going to be, "I'm going to do that, but I'm here. I am the resurrection." So we're just trying to get you to see what's going on here. It would really be good for you. And then verses 41, you have to go home and read the whole story, but verses 41 to 44, great verses. great verses. 41 to 44. Then they took away the stone. We're talking about Lazarus, right? Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. And I knew that thou hearest me always. But because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. And when he thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. Like the old preacher said, if he didn't say Lazarus, everybody in the grave would have come out. Yeah. That would have been freaky, wouldn't it? Come forth, man. Globally speaking, people would be dying of heart attacks seeing all that one time. Anyway, he mentioned his name, Lazarus. Thank God it wasn't more than one Lazarus there. We'd have a different story. And then verse 44, and he that was dead came forth bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. Jesus saith unto them, loose him and let him go. What a story. Yeah. So in verses, when you think about verse 4 and 25 and 26, Lazarus was dead. We're talking about the remedy of the obstacles is Jesus and others. Lazarus was dead. I mean, we're talking about stinking dead in verse 39, right? Yet stinketh. I mean, he's stinking. And we know that our Lord created all things, according to Colossians 1 and Hebrews 1. And our Lord can and does raise the dead. And our Lord is God. We all know that. And then in John 11, 41 to 44 that we just read, with all power that Jesus had, he wanted. Now, you got to get this. Don't miss this, the whole message. Maybe I can yell a little bit to wake you up and show you I got something, but right now I'm just working on your head a little bit. Hope you understand that, like a lobotomy. Anyway. I looked at this and looked at this and said, my goodness, would you look at the Lord here? All powerful. Yes, he is. He created everything. He spoke worlds into existence. He spoke me and you into being saved. The Word of God did. Yeah, in the beginning was the Word was with God, Word was God, right? That same God was the Word. Yep. Yeah, the Word's, you know, personification, right? God couldn't have made a mistake because it's his word. Whatever he says is good. So for people to attack our King James Bible, there's something wrong with them. Calling God a liar. But yeah, you heard the word of God. Being born again, not a corrupt seed, but incorruptible by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. Yeah, the word of God came like a sword. God illuminated you. What do you mean? Because man's in darkness under the wrath of God. If you're not saved today, you're under the wrath. I ain't going to bless you. A lot of people say, well, knock on the door and say, well, bless you, brother, I'll see you again. How can you say that? You don't know if they're going to live a second after you leave that porch or leave that where you work. You don't know that. You really don't. Think about what the scripture says. When you read John 3:16, read the rest of John 3. The wrath of God abideth on you. You are lost on your way to hell. If you die, you're going there. I mean, it's just, you get no mercy. You're in darkness. You don't know anything. And for that time in your life when God reveals himself to you for that moment, that's when you get saved. Amen. That's when I finally, as a Catholic, finally looked at Calvary like you're supposed to. Yeah. I saw the thief on the cross. I saw me in relationship to that. God revealed that to my heart. I knew all those stories, knew all those things, just wasn't saved. But God gave me that time. So what'd you do? I said, I do. I need you. I got to get saved. So what I'm saying is God has the power to do that for us. And we look at that and we see all his power. And then we notice. Jesus spoke life, number one. That's Jesus, right? And then men were used. You notice the others? To do what? To further Lazarus' movement. Lazarus come out of the grave alive. But he couldn't move because he was trapped with grave clothes. Dead people's clothes. Jesus could have, when he even spoke him in to come up out of that grave, he could have already had the stuff off of him. So it must be, it's in the book for something. They moved the stone, the hindrance, the obstacle. They moved it. You as a Christian will move it for people out there. God depends on us to move that away from them so that the life of God can come in. And then not only that, after that, guess what, bud? Your old man clothes, your grave clothes, your stinking old man comes off by others. And our pride, what? Remember? You ain't telling me what to do. I'm not submitting. And devil's always got somebody there trying to fluff it up. I don't know how many people I know that went back on drugs and alcohol because somebody says, well, you know, Jesus is loving you, have liberty. Liberty. Liberty to serve them.
Yeah.
Not liberty for yourself.
Right.
Sorry, Charlie.
Right.
That's what got you in problems. I mean, you got problems because you took liberties you shouldn't have taken.
Right.
You should have listened to your mama and daddy or your grandparents or somebody when you were younger and you just did not do it.
Right.
You created your obstacles in your life. Yeah. Number three, no man is an island. I heard that in school, and I didn't mean that because I acted like I was an island. I mean, now listen. Yes, if all the world be against God's word and you're the only one that existed, well, you would be in the majority because you'd be on God's side. But we're not in that predicament. You're not the only person. No, you're not. So you have to come back to reality. And the reality is this, we need human help. Yep.
Yes, sir.
Yep. Just any human help? No, God supplies it. God supplies it. Now this thought of no need of others, what it'll do is it'll stunt your growth. It'll prolong your ignorance in spiritual matters.
Yes.
Now, these matters could help you. And if you were helped, you definitely help others on your journey.
Yep.
But since you're stubborn, don't want to move, you're not helping you or anybody else. You're not growing in the Lord. So it's actually a suicidal, prideful, selfish thinking to think like that. I mean, you're basically unteachable. And but God has provided, here we go, the plug, right? Pastors, teachers, evangelists, for the perfecting. Go to Ephesians chapter 4. Trying to find faults in pastors and evangelists. No kidding, Sherlock. We're flesh. I mean, we're flesh. We're all flesh. But God chooses who he is. I mean, I'll tell him. I'll just say, so what? God likes retards. I'm a retard. So take it up with God. I mean, I don't know what to tell you. Well, you know, you said this and done this. So what? You know, so what? What did you do? Sometimes your kids get older, you know, well, you know, the hypocritical. You ain't a hypocrite? You did everything you said you're going to do?
Yeah, go ahead.
Kids grow up, you know, we're hypocrites when they get smart.
Yeah.
Then just say, no, a hypocrite is this. I purposely, in my heart, psyched you out and knew I was lying to you. It is not, yeah, I'm going to take you over here and do that, and the car blows up. Or there ain't enough money. When you said, and I would have, but I couldn't.
Yeah.
People don't even know what hypocrisy is.
Right.
Just amazing. Where was I before I really interrupted my own self? Okay, Ephesians 4. I like it. Ephesians 4, verses 10 and 11. We'll probably get back and read some of the verses too later. I said later. Ephesians 4. Yeah. Ye observe days and months and times and years. I'm afraid of you. Is that it? No, that's Galatians. Man, you don't want me to preach that one. Wow. Now you telling me I don't get humiliated? I just thank God that my pants ain't ripped. I don't know about you, but whenever I get too big shoddy, something happens. Yeah, that's the verse. That's what I was looking for. Yeah. Chapter 4 of Ephesians, verse 10 and 11. I should have gave Cobb my outline and he could have helped me along here. Look what it says. He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. Well, that's Jesus Christ, right? Everybody agree? So this is what Jesus did. You know, because he went up, he ascended, right? And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. For what, preacher? For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of stature, the fullness of Christ. So when's that? When we see him, we're going to be like him. So until then, we have people here to help us.
Amen.
And the help that you get is to remove some of them obstacles. I'm telling you.
Yeah.
Obstacles will kill you. So, and we're not gullible, but we do compare Scripture with Scripture to see if these things be so. So it's not just about you taking advice. It's about you knowing enough of the Bible to say, nah, mm-mm. And if not, you need to ask somebody when they're giving you advice, is that scriptural? Because we all know some things don't fit with a verse perfectly, but there's a lot of wisdom.
That's right.
And you can use that as long as you don't violate Scripture. So it's all about that book. Taking the obstacles away is a very important doctrine to understand. I mean, God's creation, we have different fingerprints, that's for sure, to prove our individuality, but we are a composite, and really get this, we are a composite of our parents, teachers, companions in this life. You think about this, I mean, who is teaching you right now? Is the world, flesh, or the devil? Because you're thinking everything, you can try to claim everything for yourself, but if you look back, you were taught something by somebody. Somebody you associated with or whatever, you put it in your body somewhere, you acted upon it. So we use other things that we've collected over the years in our process of growth and meeting each other. And so, yeah, you're original by fingerprints.
Yep.
And your personality, yeah. God gave you that personality.
Yep.
And so with your personality, you take all that information and you make it yours. You know, preacher, you get an outline. It's a good outline from somebody. And you add meat to it. Or you like me sometimes, I favor some of my messages, and I say, man, this is great. And I'm reading Spurgeon, you know, 1800s, and all of a sudden he come up with the same outline that I had. I said, what's the deal with this guy? Oh, he's only a couple hundred years before me. He must have had it first. So how in the world did I get some of that? If you live by the Spirit of God,
right. Yeah, right.
You go down a lot of the same roads. You get some good ideas. Why? Because Scripture is for it. Scripture is for it.
Yes,
but you are unique. There's no doubt about it. But you got to think about today, this week, this year. Who's been teaching you?
Yeah.
Well, preacher, the internet. Some of the people that, now they're not Christians, but they're good people. And next thing you know, the fads and fashions of the world. What are we doing?
Yeah.
You know, I'm noticing you got open carry now. I've always carried a gun, whether it was legal or illegal. I just did. And equalizer, right? Now I'm seeing all these little red dots coming on these. We never had that fancy stuff, you know. I used to always think, I'm going to hit this thing. I know it's guaranteed shock. I'm going to hit this bad boy, something's going to happen to it. Now I'm going to be looking for red dot, it ain't there, except right here where they shot me. So I just work off my front sight, whatever I get, you know, and do it. Not saying it's bad, I'm just saying I don't want to depend on something that it's a possibility that something may go wrong. But they've got some SEALs using them now over there, if you got money for Trigicon or something. And I just thought I'd say that. We're an individual, but we're not, right? Because you got that thing because you saw somebody else use it. You was watching YouTube. That's cool, man. Pop, 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 pop. I got to have that. I'll be doing what? Pop, 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 pop. Why do you dress the way you dress? I mean, think about this stuff, man. We are so influenced.
Right.
I'm not saying it's bad. I'm just saying we are influenced. And so when you start to consider that through the whole great story here of Lazarus being raised again from the dead, our Heavenly Father could have easily got him out there clothed and in his right mind. But in this story, he's trying to show you, even to move the obstacle of the stone, he had others do it.
Yeah.
And so now you got to say to yourself, how many times do you leave church or hear a message and it sort of like pricked you a little bit, and then you get mad? You didn't like say, oh man, get the altar and get right. No, because too many people would notice that you changed and you were so dogmatic about something. It's rough. It's rough to grow in the Lord, I'm telling you. And then you think about the Christian in type as the moon, you know, a type of, right? And you think about the moon rotates against the sun, I don't care what they say. And the world, if you think about it, gets light from the moon at night, and yet that moon doesn't produce light.
Yeah.
It just reflects the sun. And we are the light of the world.
Yes.
So what would stop that? Hide it under a bushel. No, I'm going to let it shine. Remember that?
Amen.
Hide it under the bushel. No. Yep. Or how about this one? Don't let the devil blow it out.
Right.
Why? Because if that happens, you get stagnated. You become mediocrity starts setting in. Next thing you know, you're on the other side of the moon. Still the moon's there, type of Christian. You're on the other side. Very dark. Dark, 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 dark.
Right.
You start going dark. And the thing about darkness, you don't know it. When you venture to get into that, you know it when you got the light, because you can see the difference. But once you get in a dark room, any of you guys, you know, even out in the woods, and the sun goes down, your eyes start to get used to that. Start to know that. And if you're familiar with the area, not go somewhere where you get lost and like almost die in the wilderness. But I mean, if you're familiar with the area, you know, eventually you'll focus and you look up at the stars sometimes, and that light sometimes gets in them reticles somehow and you can see a little bit better. And same thing in a room. Even in your bedroom, you go to sleep at night, you get up at first, you know, you look around, ain't nothing there. Then all of a sudden you start to get used to it. You start seeing things. And the problem with darkness is you're deceived. You don't even know you're in it. You get used to it.
Yeah.
And then next thing you know, you start getting mad at people that call you out on certain things.
Amen.
And you try to justify it. And so what you're doing is you're becoming unteachable. And when you become unteachable, then God's going to just step back like this and say, okay. And most of the chastisement, he just got to step back because your life will hurt you.
Yeah.
You'll hurt yourself. And the people around you make you very difficult. So the Christian in type of the moon rotates against the sun and the world, and the next thing you know, the only light you got is from the sun for sure. It reflects the light of the sun, and you don't want to go in the other side because that's darkness. So Christians must have their obstacles removed. Everybody agree?
Yes, sir.
Okay. But first, you must be able to see them. Now, the devil deceives. How do you know that? Because the world becomes normal to us, and it's not our enemy anymore. Yeah. The Word of God, by the power of the Holy Ghost, reveals our obstacles by illumination. We don't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God.
Right.
And you think about that, and you think about that, and it's so true because what stopped you from reading your Bible every day? You know, you get a good meeting or something, you get right with God and you're pumped up and yeah, I'm going to read my Bible through this time for sure, this year. You get bogged down with a month. And then pretty soon you feel bad, so you don't go back. You just keep going on. And you don't read. You don't read. And you miss the whole spiritual teaching of the Word of God being your bread, your necessary bread. Because pretty soon you're gonna feel famished. You're gonna be agreeing more with the world. You're gonna feel comfortable in the world. And pretty soon you're gonna argue with people that try to instruct you. And you'll be out of church, you'll be out of that kind of fellowship, and they're gonna find you in the dark side.
Yep.
You can only fake it for so long.
Right.
Those are all obstacles.
Yes, sir.
How do you know that? Because I've been there.
Sure.
It's bad. Very, very bad. And I'm telling you, we read Ephesians 4:11 through 16 about the gifts. Go down to Hebrews 13. Now, you go out of here this week and not get anything, you have to ask yourself, why am I not getting anything? Am I fighting this thing, or have I been in the world too much that it's not affecting me? Because, see, those things like that are triggers for the Christian to hit the altar, go somewhere, get along with God, and say, God, man, I'm cold.
Yeah.
Everybody else is amen or, you know, excited about the things of God or getting stuff from the Word of God, and I'm not getting it. Well, if you know you made that salvation commitment and you know God saved you because you're the only witness to that, if you know that took place, then guess what? You move from God.
Right.
So what do you need? You need God.
Right.
I come boldly before the throne of grace to obtain what? Mercy. You need mercy.
Yep.
Don't worry about grace right now. You better get you some mercy. Because
right.
Yep. That's what you got to have.
Yes,
you get that mercy, you'll see that you got the mercy. Why? Because all of a sudden, bing, God will start speaking to you. The birds will start chirping a little bit, and you'll say, man, this is really real. Yeah, just think, if you'd have listened like 5-10 years ago, you could have been caught up on all this stuff. And as soon as you messed up, what should you do? Get on your knees somewhere. Tell God I'm sorry. What's wrong with telling God you're sorry?
Right.
I got these people, man.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I come across these people, these hypers. Even had a band start my church, and somebody went that way, supposed to be sound. And I'd do it to her, but I'd have problems later. You got a bad left foot?
No.
Okay. No, I just did that to him. And I'm walking away, right? And he's sitting there saying, now, if he wouldn't know I was setting him up, he'd wonder, didn't that dude know he just kicked me? You hear him? What's up with that? Why would he even think like that? Because the normal response is what? Oh, man, I'm sorry, brother. I'm sorry. I didn't see that foot there. I mean, even if you were a dirty dog, you'd probably say you were sorry to somebody. And here we got Christians.
Yeah.
You grieve the Holy Spirit, and instead of you immediately saying, I'm sorry, you're just going to go on and forget about it. Well, God don't forget about it.
Amen.
And you're building on that because there's going to be more time to do that. Why? Because we're creatures of habit, and you haven't made a good habit of doing that. You're not polite, you're insensitive to God, and you're treating them like a dog.
Yeah.
Tell them you're sorry.
Yeah.
Don't let your pride stop you from telling God you're sorry. And you're different than I. Birds may stop chirping in your life over something else that I could do, and it never affect me. You see what I mean? But I'm just trying to help you. If you immediately get right with God by telling him you're sorry, he sees your concern, he knows your growth, and he's going to help you out. You'll be stronger next time.
Amen.
But if you think about when you were saved, some were saved younger, got away from God for 10, 15 years. Man, they went through all that problem. Well, why'd they come back? Somehow, repentance, and somehow the Holy Ghost finally convinced them that they need God. And now that convincing could be death of wife, husband, kids, them having difficulty, cancer, or whatever. God will send certain messengers in your life to get your attention.
Amen.
And then what do? Then you got to go back like a little baby and start growing.
Yeah, that's right.
So why do all that junk?
Yeah.
Just tell them you're sorry.
Yeah.
I mean, all this week, I'm telling you what, when we first started off, me and the wife, that club life and all that junk, I camped at the altar. I basically, every time I come up, people probably really did think I was retired. What's wrong with that guy? He keeps hitting the altar. Because things keep coming in my mind.
Sure.
And I don't know how to handle it. So I just keep coming to God. I don't care who's around. Say, God, I need some help here or there. I'm not coming to the altar for y'all. I'm coming here to show God that I'm not embarrassed to embarrass myself to come.
Right.
When you embarrass yourself, what happens to your body? It flames up. Just like when you sin.
Yep.
Ain't nobody around. And here you're going to go whatever. And as soon as you're done, what happens to you? You get flushed. You get burned up. You don't understand.
Right.
All of a sudden, now you start feeling bad. See, you forgot you got God in you. And so that Holy Spirit, you grieved him.
Yep.
And when you grieved him, that's what you're sensing, that grieving. Mm-hmm. And the way he puts up with us. Did I even read Hebrews 13? Sorry, God.
Yep.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Too far. James, yeah, all right, okay, close. Good old James. Hebrews 13. I know you congregations love these verses. Let's look at 7 and 17, chapter 13. Remember them which have the rule over you. What's that word? Rule. Man, yeah, well, you can't lord things over us. I got the Bible over there. Well, how about ruling? Is ruling good? Did you ever look up a definition? Anyway, it says, who have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith what? Follow, considering the end of their conversation. What is that? Their life. What's God done for them? How did they step out on faith? What is faith? You're sitting in a pew. You're working. What's faith? Well, faith is what's in you. You got saved. And it's your belief of what? The scripture. And so when you see other people that have obeyed certain scriptures and how God blesses them using them scriptures, you say, well, wow, that could probably happen for me too. And then you venture out, and next thing you know, by faith you believe the scripture, and you start acting upon it, and next thing you know, you're getting blessed and you're growing because you followed that leadership. Very, very important, very important. In verse 17, obey them that have the rule over you, and what? Submit yourselves, for they do what? Watch for your souls, as they that must what? Give an account. So why do they do it? They have to give an account, that they may do it with joy, now watch it, and not with grief, for that is unprofitable to who? You. So a lot of times when you get the pastors trying to help you out, trying to do this or that, and you might view it a different way, a skewed view or whatever, and you're just not trusting, and you do what you're just going to do, then things happen. Things happen. To who? You. To you. And then also 24 and 25. The Bible says, for he beholdeth himself and goeth his way. No, Nagelski. Here we go, Hebrews 13. James come up. 24 and 25. I hate that because it distracts from the message. I was so perfect in delivery. Anyway, 24 and 25. Look what it says. It be saying, Ebonic, no. Salute all them. Wow, like military, right? Salute all them that have the rule over you and all the saints. Wow. They of Italy salute you. Grace be with you all. Amen. Amen. My goodness, like a military. So what does it mean? It means please stop fighting those voices that want to help you.
Amen.
You got to stop it. Just calm down. Just calm down, man. Chill. Get all huffy and junk. We forget God can see the heart.
Yes.
So when you sit in church, you can have a smile. You can say, yeah. You know, but you ain't changing.
Yeah.
You bless your little heart, you just ain't going to change. You will not submit. Please watch out for that. We're in a day and age now, people. Never the likes. I mean, it's close to Lot and it's close to Noah, but I'm telling you what, this is unique, the way this thing is.
Yep.
Especially in our country. I mean, what grandpa would have all of a sudden thought that his great-great-grandkid wanted to be a girl that was a boy? And or a garbage can, or whatever they want to be. They can just fill in. I am in a garbage can. No, you're not. You're stinking stupid. You're a psychopath. You're out of your mind. You've been eating mushrooms, smoking dope. Something's going on with you, man. You're nuts. I mean, that's the normal response. But everybody went to sleep. Stop being vigilant like the forefathers said. So what'd you do? You let teachers from the world come in here and teach your kids propaganda. You didn't even look at their homework. Nobody looked at what they were even being taught. They didn't care. They went to work, made their money, bought their toys, and forget about my kids. That's the teacher's job. No, that's your job. Right. Always has been your job.
Amen.
Why? Stubborn, man. People aren't listening.
Yep.
And that's what worries me about my kids, my grandkids. I mean, you know, you don't want stuff them to get fruitcakey, honey. I mean, I tell you, I'm working on tenderness and stuff still after all these years. I'll smack one of them. They know it. And they know to leave the house for a while. I don't know about you, but I was taught right.
Amen. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm not gonna go back on that. Everybody's trying to run to the forefathers now. Why didn't you know? Why didn't you already have that spirit? You know? I mean, why do you need all that backing to be a man or to be, you know, to be a protector or a woman, you know? I mean, that's already, you're built in innate. I mean, God created man and women, right?
Yep.
And then the Spirit of God comes in, you're saved. What you been doing with your life? Who you been listening to? Something, man, made you effeminate or something.
Yeah.
You protect. You stand for the truth. And they want to get fruitcakey and nuts, that's them. That is not you. And you stand up against them. And you can't do it because you got too many obstacles. It'll drain you from your power. So God uses human instrumentality in our salvation and your growth. And that's by the means of delivering the truth. We're to put on, we're to put off things, and we're to add to our faith some things.
Right.
And I'll close with this. Are you trapped in an addiction? And I'll start off with the unusual, gossip. How's that? That's an addiction.
Yeah.
Can't keep your mouth shut. He is running your mouth all the time. I'm not going to get on the women. I was tempted, but I'm not going to get on women. But gossip, that's an addiction. It really is. And it ruins families. It ruins churches.
Yes, it does.
Yeah, keep your cotton pig mouth shut.
Yeah. Amen.
I mean, when the Lord says, you know, we got to forgive everybody because he forgave us, think about what he forgave you from.
Yeah.
What have you been forgiven for? You know? Think about that addiction. How about drugs? Well, my doctor gives it to me for, you know, what ails me. Well, are you experiencing that much pain, or do you really like the feeling that you get off the drug that's supposed to help you with the pain?
Right.
You got to make the call. And alcohol? I found out a good friend of mine was nipping, and he finally went before the church and confessed it. Blew everybody's mind. Nobody knew. You know, he'd get his pint every day. And he could maintain leading music. He could maintain doing all that. And he did good. I mean, fool me. Well, God finally got a hold of him. He felt so bad living that quiet life. He got right.
Amen.
And he went before the church. I mean, he got right. He wanted everybody to know what he did. Why? Because he offended the church. You offend the church when you do stuff.
Yep.
You act stupid out there. And they look at the church. They're not really looking at you because the devil wants them to hate the local body.
Right.
And he will use that body to work against the church. And I'm just telling you, if you got all sorts of obstacles, and it's because of your pride, and you just don't want to grow and learn, you're a hindrance. You're going to hurt yourself and your family. So if you're trapped in an addiction, alcohol, and how about pornography? I don't even look at the church. I don't even look at the guy's eyeballs. Because when we're up here, you know, you can look at everybody. I don't even do that because I already know that stuff's out there. Yeah. On the phone. I mean, quick. In your car. You know. And that's one of those private things, it seems like. But you need to get right in private then.
Yeah.
And you need to get power. And if you can't get power to control that behavior, go talk to your pastor. And if he's God's pastor, he's not going to go blab nothing. Just you and him.
Yeah.
Because it'll ruin you. Because every time you look at a chick in the church or anywhere, guess what you're thinking? Them films.
Yep.
Sorry, it is. It's like a drug. It makes a thing in your brain. But you can get over it. There's deliverance. Yes, yes, there is. But you got to fess up. That is a great obstacle, because next thing you know, you got thoughts of fantasy. That's all you do all day long. You're fantasizing. That power, man, is so great. Sometimes people get in car accidents. What were you thinking? They can't tell you. They weren't thinking right. They weren't focusing on the road. I mean, you become a slave to the flesh,
yeah.
And you got to get victory. Get victory. Please get victory. Get instruction. Get humility. And do what? Get back to the biblical program, man. Some people need to get saved, but most people need to get right in the local church. This is a morning service. This is you guys. And I don't know how long it went, but so shame on you. But amen. You just think about where you are right now, because this is the beginning. And it may not get better tonight when I preach, so you better not come. I mean, because you never know. You don't even know. I don't even know sometimes when I get up here. But I'll tell you this. There's obstacles always in the Christian's life. But you got to remove them. Whatever's keeping you from serving, whatever's even keeping you from reading your Bible every morning, what is it?
Yeah.
And most of the time for the Bible thing, it's just you got no character.
Yeah.
You'll hunt. You'll go out there, and some people stay in a tree forever.
Yeah.
Waiting on something, frostbitten, won't even go to the bathroom because surely when they do, they're going to rustle something, they're not going to get that buck. I mean, you will be determined to do that, but yet with the Lord to read the Bible, I'll catch it later. I'll get a little bit over here, a little bit over there. You're losing power, the transforming power of your mind to think right. The thoughts and intents of the heart are against God. And the only way you can combat that is with the book. That's supernatural. You've got to have supernatural food.
Yep.
So this week you ask the Lord to reveal to you what's hindering you. Maybe from growth, maybe from a calling. There's something in your way. There's something you're placing over God. And if there is, get right. That's all. If somebody in the church, just get right. Suck it up. Said something stupid or did something, just suck it up. Tell them you're sorry. Life goes on. Don't stop anything that the Holy Ghost wants to do in your life this week. Just relax.
Yeah.
Something comes up, hit the altar. Say, God, I'm sorry. Somebody in the church keeps coming in your mind, and God's unique like that. He'll not only put the face in the mind, but he'll put what happened. Get that thing right. Just say you're sorry. It'll work. Let's all bow our heads and let God deal with whatever you got to do here. You know where you are. You know where you have been. You know what you're going to do afterwards. Get God in it. You say it'll spoil my fun. No, it'll increase your joy.
Yeah. One of the things that I enjoy about Brother Nagowski's preaching is he's not politically correct, but he's biblically correct. He does something that a lot of preachers have given up on today, and that's make people think. And I want to just tell you one of the things that, I'm not going to re-preach his message, but I want to emphasize something. He talked in there about this mentality of, I don't need anybody. And he said that was suicidal, prideful, and selfish. Some people will ask God, God, would you help me with this? God, help me with this. I need help with this. And God wants to help you, but you don't want God to help you the way he wants to help you. You want to dictate to God how he is to help you. And there are people in this room that God has wanted to help for years. But the reason, and you think God hasn't helped you, it's not that God hasn't helped you, it's he wanted to use somebody else to help you. You didn't want somebody else to help you. You wanted God to flip a switch and all of a sudden be fixed. And God says, no, the way I want to help you is I want to put somebody in your life to help you. But you're not going to let him help you that way. And you have shut out the very people that God has put in your life to help you. You know what that leads to? Unnecessary years of struggling. And you could have been so much further down the road than where you're at now. But you decided to dictate to God how he is supposed to help you. You say, well, how do I fix that? Just do what he just said at the end. Just confess it. I'm sorry, Lord. Help me. You don't think God's big enough to show you? But you've got to listen to that still small voice. And if you've got a lot of other volume and you've got a lot of other noise and you've got a lot of other things in your life, you're not going to hear that still small voice. It all goes back to that pride. We don't want anybody to know what we struggle with. Well, the devil's already got you fooled because probably everybody already knows what you struggle with because we're humans and we all struggle with the same thing. It's that PhD in fleshology that he was talking about. That's why it's easy for God to use people to put in our lives to help us with struggling because they've probably struggled with the same things. And we think, well, I don't want them to think bad about me. I don't want them to know. Why don't you forget that junk and just accept the help that God wants to give you? Sister Charity's going to play. I think it's a good time to make a move to the altar for God's people. You don't want to come to the altar, just kneel there in your chair. But don't say, I don't have to move. You better move your heart. Rend your hearts and not your garments. Well, God, nobody's going to tell me to hit the altar. Yep, there's that old flesh again. There's that pride. And you're going to do exactly what we preached about Wednesday night. You're going to quench the spirit. Father, bless the invitation, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.